These chains will never break. But they don't know you like we do. There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the tide will never change.
Break. I will cling to your unchanging grace. solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock.
On Christ's solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock.
On Christ's solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands.
I was running around brokenhearted. I was thinking so fast I couldn't last, falling apart. And you could have ran away, leaving me there in my shame, leaving me finding my pain. But you made a better way. Oh, oh, oh.
I've been saved.
Goodbye to the sinner. I'm held by the Father above.
No more shame.
For I'm out of the desert and drowned in the power of love. Amazing. Open, you show me all of my life in a new light. Every step, every breath, like it's the first time.
You could have ran away,
leaving me there in my shame, leaving me fighting my pain, but you made a better way. Oh, oh, oh.
I've been saved.
Goodbye to the sinner. I'm held by the Father above.
No more shame.
For I'm out of the desert and drowned in the power of love. Amazing. Told me the good, good news.
Oh, oh.
Went way down deep in the river blue.
Oh, oh.
The preacher told me the good, good news.
Oh, oh.
And ever since my heart met you,
I've been saved.
Drown in the power of love. Amazing grace, my soul set free. Ain't no grave got a hold on me. I'm born again, I'm born again. Washed by the water, I'm clean.
Yeah.
Washed by the water, washed by the water.
Even in the madness, there is peace. Now, you may be able to tame a bucking bronco or a wildcat, but you can't tame a tongue. If your tongue is always getting you into trouble, saying things that shouldn't be said, here's something you can do.
Psalm 34, verse 13. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking lies.
Keep your tongue from evil, keep your tongue. Keep your tongue from evil, keep your tongue. And your lips from speaking lies. Keep your tongue from evil, keep your tongue.
Now grab hold of your tongue while we sing it again.
Keep your tongue from evil, keep your tongue. Keep your tongue from evil, keep your tongue. And your lips from speaking lies. Keep your tongue from evil, keep your tongue.
Can I let go of my tongue now?
Hey, what a great song. That song might be new to you here, but I got to tell you, the church where Lori and I used to attend, we would sing that song every year for preschool vacation Bible school. And when my kids were little, they would sing that song all the time. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking lies. Today I want to talk to you about the power of the tongue. And if you tuned in this morning and you were hoping to hear Russ preach, I just want to say, Russ will be back next week, but I'm filling in for him today. And my name's Scott Seppelt. If you've got your Bibles handy there close to you at your house, I challenge you to go ahead and grab them, because we're going to be looking at James chapter 3 this morning. And in this chapter, James talks about the power of our tongue. And he starts off in verse 1 and he says this, "Not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. Anyone who is never at fault with what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. When we put bits into the mouths of horses, we can make them obey us. We can turn the whole animal. Or take ships for an example. Although they are so large and they're driven by strong winds, they are steered with a very small rudder, wherever the pilot wants to make them go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body and sets the whole course of one's life on fire. It and is itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, sea creatures are being tamed by mankind, but no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With the tongue, we praise our Lord and Father. And with it, we curse human beings who've been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth comes praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water." Let's open with prayer. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for James, the brother of Jesus, whom you inspired to write these words to us. And now, Lord God, we ask that you would move in our hearts. Lord God, you would give us ears that we would hear so that we might change our hearts and our lives according to what you called us to be. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, let me start off by just saying this. Most of us like to talk. Most of us like to talk. A university in California did a study, and maybe you heard this, you've seen these results before, but you know what? That study showed that the average man speaks about 7,000 words in a day. And it went on to find out that the average woman speaks about 20,000 words a day. Listen, I'm going to leave that right there. You can draw whatever conclusion you want on that, okay? But that's what the study shows. And one of the guys, he was asked, they asked one of the guys this, "Do you resent that your wife always gets the last word?" And he said, no, not at all. He said, "I'm just glad when she finally gets to the last word." Listen, sorry, ladies. Oh, we like to talk. We do. And some of us, you know what? We're a little bit more on the shy side. Some of us are a little bit more introverted. But let's be honest. we still talk to ourselves a lot. There's a lot going on up here. There's a lot of dialogue that happens in our mind. And of course, you know what? We don't only communicate through words. We also communicate through emails, text, tweets, and other forms of social media. The fact is this, guys, our mouths can get us in a lot of trouble. And that reminds me of this story. There was this guy, young man, he worked in the produce section at the local grocery store. And one day, this little old lady came up to him, and she asked him, she said, "I'd like to buy a half a head of lettuce." And he said to her, he said, "Excuse me?" And so she repeated herself. She said, "I'd like to buy a half a head of lettuce." And he said to her, he said, "Ma'am, God grows lettuce in whole heads, and that's the way we sell them here at this grocery store." And the lady said to him, she said, "Son, I've been shopping at this grocery store before you were even born." And so the produce clerk, he said to her, he said, "Ma'am, do you want me to inquire with the manager?" And she said, "Yes." And so he turned and he walked to the front of the store to locate the manager. But he was unaware that the lady had followed him. And as he located the manager, he said to the manager this. He said, "You're not going to believe this." He said, "But there's this old ditzy woman in the back that wants to buy a half a head of lettuce." And he knew as soon as he said it, something was wrong by just the way the manager's face looked. And he glanced over his shoulder, and the lady was standing right behind him. And being quick thinking, he said to him, and he said, "And oh, by the way, this lady, this sweet lady here, she'd like to buy that other half a head of lettuce." Listen, the fact is this, you know what, we're not usually as quick as that guy when it comes to getting ourselves out of trouble. But the fact is, all of us have learned at one time or another that, you know what, our words can get us into a lot of trouble. And it appears to me, the people that James is writing to, that they weren't using their tongues very wisely. Because James touches on this issue all the way throughout his book. He starts off in James chapter 1, verse 19, and I want to challenge you. This is a great verse to commit to memory. James 1, 19. James says this: "Everyone should be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to become angry." Quick to listen. You know what that means? That means shut your mouth. I said this to my kids all the time as they were growing up, my boys Luke and my daughter Stacy. God gave you two ears and one mouth. Listen twice as much as you talk. James goes on in the first chapter, his first chapter, in verse 26, and he writes this. He said, "Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongue, they deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless." And here in this chapter, chapter 3, he devotes 12 verses to the subject of our tongue. Given that this subject is throughout this letter, he's telling us how we should use our tongue, and that the way we use our tongue, it's a big deal, because the tongue is powerful. God gave you and I an incredible power when he gave us the ability to speak. And no power that God has given us has greater implications on a healthy or unhealthy relationship than the power of our words. Proverbs 18:21 says, "The tongue has the power of death and life." Our words can either give life or they can take it. Our words can either nourish or they can destroy. What James is going to show is why we need to be wise with the words we use. The first thing I want to take a look at, and the first thing that James tells us is that our words have the ability to impact a person's destiny. In verse 3, he says this: "When we put bits in the mouths of horses, we can make them obey us. We can turn the whole animal. Did you know that a 60-pound child can control a 2,000-pound horse if they know what they're doing, with just a little piece of metal put in that horse's mouth?" James goes on in verse 4 and he says, "The direction of a large ship, a sailing ship, is determined by a very, very small rudder." James goes on to say, "In the same way, the tongue is a relatively small part of our body, but that movable muscular structure in our mouth can say things that influence the past of a person's life." All of us can remember a time in our life when someone used hurtful words that impacted us. Maybe it, for you it was in the last year, or in the last 5 years, or maybe it was 20 plus years ago. But those words scarred us, impacting us to this very day in a negative way. But on the other hand, many of us can remember the life-giving words or the teaching of someone that not only encouraged us, but challenged us to change to live differently, perhaps changing the whole direction of our lives. See, words are powerful. Secondly, we see the tongue has the power to destroy. Look at verse 5. It says this, "Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boast. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark." Last October, a colleague of mine that worked for a different agency called me up on the phone, and he offered me a job. But the job was going to require me to locate to Paradise, California. And the job was to help remove all the devastation out there so that that area could start to be rebuilt. Because you see, in 2018, there was a fire that started there. And the fire spread, and it burned over 153,000 acres. It burned for 17 days, and it leveled 18,000 buildings, which included a hospital, houses, businesses, schools. And on top of all of that, it took the lives of 85 people. All that devastation, it started from a spark from a power line. And what James is saying is that that kind of power the tongue can have in a human relationship. A small spark from an ill-spoken word can start a firestorm, and that can destroy a marriage. It can destroy a career, a reputation, even a life. In verse 6, James also says this, "The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among all the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person. It sets the whole course of its life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell." Now I want to tell you, verse 6, that's a mouthful. And you might be saying to yourself, what is James exactly trying to say there? And this is what he's really saying is this. Everything in us that we haven't repented of, and we haven't submitted to God, things like arrogance, pride, anger, unforgiveness, insecurities, the total sum of those over time, they make their way out through our mouth and out through our tongue. The fire that wages within us, it finds its way out of our mouths. And it has the potential to spread to others. And when it does, I want to tell you, it causes a chain reaction and it wreaks havoc in our lives. One way the tongue destroys is through dishonesty. Dishonesty causes others not to trust us anymore. Dishonesty, it can come in many forms. It can come from just outright lying or embellishing, but it also comes when we can't keep things confident. We can't keep things to ourselves. In Proverbs chapter 20, verse 19, it says this, "A gossip betrays the confidence, so avoid a man who talks too much." I kind of paraphrase this, and I've said this for years to my family and to my friends. Where words are many, sin is sure to follow. Another way the tongue is destructive is through slanderous gossip. And I got to tell you, what slanderous gossip is, in its attempt, it's an attempt to destroy someone's name, to destroy their character or their reputation. And Solomon, Jesus said, you know, Solomon, a wise man, Solomon wrote this in Proverbs 18:8. He said, "The words of a gossip are like choice morsels. They go down to the man's innermost parts." What he's saying here is this, the gossip, the person that's gossiping, to them, gossip is a great dessert. They love to gossip. They savor it. They love the taste of it. I wonder how many of people's friendships are built on gossip. Talking about somebody, ripping them, ripping a politician, coworkers talking about their boss, putting down this group of people or that group of people. And I wonder, if one of those people would just stop gossiping, if there would still be a friendship there. Slanderous gossip is anything that we say tearing someone down instead of building them up. And I'm going to tell you something. That includes emails. That includes texts. That includes tweets. And yes, that includes Facebook posts. Listen, I've observed and read posts on Facebook that people write behind a computer screen that they would never, ever say to a person's face. How many people do we lose each and every year to suicide? Not because of a mental illness, not because of some chemical imbalance, because of constant mocking and belittling. I gotta tell you how sad we are as a society because of all the things that are being said and posted, putting other people down. When Lori and I were youth sponsors at our other church, and we were youth sponsors there for over a decade, I remember one night we were speaking on the topic of the power of the tongue. And every night we would have games for the teenagers to come up and play before the message was brought up. And there was this game where we called up two teenagers, and everybody was going crazy and wild and loving and everything. And we said, here's the game. There was two tubes of toothpaste and two bowls on the table. And we said, here's the game. You have to unscrew the top of the toothpaste, and as fast as you can, you got to get all that toothpaste out of that tube of toothpaste and into that bowl. And we said, ready, go. And they started squeezing and rolling, and all of a sudden, one of them would win, and all the teens were going crazy and stuff like that. And we said, okay, now, here to claim your prize, you have to do this. You got to get all that toothpaste back into that tube. And both contestants would look at the youth minister there and say, how do we do that? And the people in the audience would laugh and everything like that. I think you get the point. Words are easy to say. Words are easy to get out. But I got to tell you, sometimes they're nearly impossible to take back. Our criticism, our slander, our gossip, it not only possibly destroys the one that we're directing it at, but one day we're going to have to give an account for it. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 12, verse 36. And this is Jesus speaking. He said, but I tell you that men will give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word that they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. Paul says this, and he follows that same thought back up. He says, God will not be deceived. Whatever you sow, you will reap. So James is telling us the tongue is powerful. It has the power to destroy. But the third point I want to make about the tongue this morning is this. The tongue has the power to bless. James wants us to understand that while the tongue can do enormous, it has enormous power to do destruction, it also has tremendous power to bless others. The tongue is not limited in how good it can do. Look at verse 9 again in James chapter 3. James says this. We can praise the Lord with our tongues. We can give thanks. You know what? We can bless others with words of praise, with words of affirmation, with words of encouragement. I'm sure all of us can think of a time in our life when there was somebody that we really, really looked up to. We respected them. And you know what? They affirmed us and they complimented us. Maybe they said to you, man, you are such a strong leader. Maybe they told you you're a good teacher. You're a hard worker. Maybe somebody told you in the past, you are so generous, you're so kind, you're so thoughtful. You know what? All of us have the capacity to speak unbelievable life into other people through our words. Words that will set people's heart not on fire, but it'll set them soaring. We can also bless those, you know, that we're close to with words of correction. Let me repeat that. We can also bless those that we're close to with words of correction. Notice I said the word close to. Someone that we love. Someone that we've built a relationship with. Instead of talking about this with everyone else, instead of telling other people, other Christians, hey, we need to pray for so-and-so. They're struggling with this or they're struggling with that. Spreading negative garbage. We need to do what God wants us to do. A true friend will take a risk. And they will come to you with the utmost respect, and they will talk to you about the concern that they have. This is how God wants us to go. Step one, God wants us to take this to Him. Step two, God wants us to take that to them. I have a friend named Randy. And Randy and I worked together for over 30 years. And for those that you don't know this morning, I was a firefighter for 35 years. In those 30 years, I spent a lot of time, Randy and I worked together a lot of it. And when you're a firefighter, you spend about a third of the year with your crew and your company that you work with. That's day and night. You know what? Randy and I grew close to one another. We did family vacations together. Randy and I knew each other almost as well as our wives knew us. And then I got promoted to chief, and Randy got promoted to battalion chief. And as any leader of an organization, any boss, I had to make decisions on the direction of which the department was going. And the way I would convey that or communicate that to the whole department would be either through staff meetings, officers meetings, memos, standard operating guidelines, rules, regulations, and I would use emails and other ways to get that message out. And I got to tell you, Randy and I would talk all the time. And I remember there were times when Randy would come into my office and he would say, "Hey, Scott, can we talk?" And I said, "Yeah." And he would close the door. And every time he would close the door, I knew it was something serious. Randy would say to me, he'd say, "You know what, Scott? I know what you're trying to achieve, but it's not being received that way." Or he would go on to say, "It's not being received at all." And many times, you know what? These were things that I was blind to, things that I was unaware of. Randy loved and cared enough for me and the department that he took the risk to come and tell me. And if I'm going to be honest with you, there were times when Randy would come to me and I would shoot the messenger. I'd fire right back at Randy. I'd argue with him, only to think about it later and then call him back in or call him on the phone and apologize. And after that, then I'd usually put out a clarification or a retraction to what I had issued or what I had said. Randy wanted me to excel. He had my best interest at heart. Randy's a true friend. I hope that you have a Randy in your life. I also hope that you're a Randy to those people that you're close to, your family and your friends. This is a way that, you know what, the tongue has the power to bless. Imagine if every one of us had the best interest of others and we put them ahead of ourselves. That's what Jesus said when he said, "Love your neighbor as you love yourself." Using our tongues, you know what? We can speak life into people. Imagine more and more, if more and more of our conversations with friends and families were focused on what God was doing in our life, how God answered our prayers, the great things that's happening here at Seppelt Church, all that God's doing in the lives of other people and how they're impacting other people. And instead of putting people down, you know what? We celebrated the way people were impacting other people and the victories that were going on in our world. Listen, I could go on and on. The tongue has the power to bless. And the last thing I want to hit on is the tongue only reflects what's in our heart. Look at verse 9 and follow again. It says this: "With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who are made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursings." My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh and salt water flow from the same spring? Can a fig tree bear olives, or can a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. What James is saying here is this: whatever's in the well, that's what's coming out in the water. Whatever's in that tree's DNA, that's what's coming out in the fruit. And in the same way he's saying this, whatever's in our heart, that's what's coming out our mouths. Our words are nothing more than a litmus test of what's going on in our hearts. It's a reflection of what's happening right here, right here. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 34, Jesus says this: "For out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks." The mouth speaks what the heart is full of. If gossip, slander, profanity, grumblings, if those are what's coming out of your mouth, can I tell you something? It's just revealing that there's something wrong going on in your heart. This is revealing that, you know what, there's still a lot of worldliness in our hearts, and we need to turn that over to God. Let me repeat James 3:7 again. No human being can tame the tongue. You know what? We can teach horses to dance, ships to go wherever we want them to go. There are people that can teach elephants how to play soccer and dolphins how to jump through hoops. But the Bible says that no human being can tame the tongue. James is saying, you know what? We can't tame the tongue in our own strength. See, being a Christian, it's not some self-improvement plan. We can't tame the tongue. You know why? Because we can't change our heart. Only God can change our heart. In the Old Testament, we read the story of King David. And King David was a warrior. He was a soldier. He was one of the best fighting men there was. And he became king. And the army of Israel was out fighting. And King David should have been out with the army. That's what he was called to do. But one night he stayed back while the army was out fighting. And one night he couldn't sleep. And he was out on this roof. And he was looking. And he seen this beautiful woman naked taking a bath. And he got that woman pregnant. And then to cover that up, he had that woman's husband killed. And Randy, a good friend of the king's, came and he confronted the king. And he told him, what you've done, you've sinned. You've sinned. And David was cut to his heart. And we read in Psalm 51, which David wrote, he pleaded with God. He said, God, have mercy on me and cleanse me from my sins that I've committed. And then he prayed this. He said, create in me a pure heart, O God. If you're struggling with your tongue, I challenge you. Go to Psalm 51. Read it as a prayer to God. This is what it says. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my inequities and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sins are always before me. They're against you, God, and you only. I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. That's the prayer David had to the Lord. And if you feel that guilt of things that you've said, I challenge you, go to Psalm 51 and read that as a prayer to God. Let me end this morning with this. I want to be completely honest with you. When I speak, and I've shared this many times when I've spoke before, when Russ has asked me to speak, I'm thankful. Russ always gives me the freedom to speak what's on my heart, to speak what I'm reading about or what I'm studying or what I'm dealing with or what I'm struggling with. And I got to tell you, my mother-in-law passed away in May. She died of Alzheimer's. And my wife asked me to speak at her funeral. And I really felt the weight of this because I wanted to honor her. And I said this at her funeral. I have known my mother-in-law. I met her and Lori on the same day in spring of 1980. I knew Minnie for 40 years. I never heard my mother-in-law ever say a bad word about another person. I never heard my mother-in-law ever use profanity. Her words were always words of encouragement. They were always words to edify and to strengthen. They were words to bless. You know what? I want to have a tongue like my mother-in-law. She was a God-fearing woman. And I got to tell you, studying for this message, it's shown me that I need to grow in the area of my tongue. I got to tell you, I admit to you today, I struggle with the things I say. I obviously have heart issues that I'm working on. And the first step to a road to recovery is admitting that you have a problem. And so here's the takeaway. Here's the takeaway I hope you take away today, and that is this. Every time you catch yourself grumbling or complaining, recognize that there's something going on in here, something that's not right. Ask God to help you and ask others to help hold you accountable. Let's pray. Father God in heaven, my prayer today is, Lord God, that you would give us a pure and a clean heart. And that the words we speak would be words of blessings, words of uplifting and encouragement, strengthening those that we come in contact with. For God, Father, I ask you that you would forgive me and others who struggle with the words that we speak. I ask, Lord God, please don't take your Holy Spirit. Father, soften our hearts that we can hear you better, apply your teachings to our life, that we might become more and more like your son, Jesus, each and every day. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
more.